Let us start with a short prayer. Okay, so let's all be still and know that God is always with us and God is with us in all ways. Let us pray. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. If today you hear His voice, harden not your hearts. Come, let us sing joyfully to the Lord. Let us acclaim the rock of our salvation. Let us come into His presence with thanksgiving. Let us joyfully sing psalms to Him. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord who made us. For He is our God, and we are the people He shepherds, the flock He guides. Oh, that today you would hear His voice. Harden not your hearts, as at Meribah, as in the day of Massa, in the desert, where your fathers tempted me. They tested me, though they had seen my works. Brothers and sisters, let us ask for the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Breathe in me, O Holy Spirit, that my thoughts may all be holy. Act in me, O Holy Spirit, that my work too may be holy. Draw my heart, O Holy Spirit, that I love but what is holy. Strengthen me, O Holy Spirit, to defend all that is holy. And guard me then, O Holy Spirit, that I always may be holy. Amen. And so, brothers and sisters, the theme for the day is authority. No? Authority. And
parang nakat.
Ha? Oo. Inano ko muna. Magbibigay muna ako ng konting ano. The theme for today is authority. And authority is defined as the power to enforce obedience. That is when we listen and we act accordingly. However, it seems that there are many different types of authority. And there is authority that is arrogant, domineering, and life-threatening. Yung bang demanding at pinipilit ka. And there is the type of authority that is gentle, inviting, and life-giving. And the word authority can also be understood in many different ways. When someone delivers a good talk about a topic that they are expert in or maybe are passionate about, we say that they are an authority on the topic. There is also spiritual authority when it is the authority to share wisdom, to forgive, to enhance life. And spiritual authority is gentle, inviting, and life-giving. The authority of Jesus is gentle, inviting, and life-giving. He demonstrated this through the power of the word and deed. Authority in gentle words that invite life-giving actions, and authority in deeds that enhance and give witness to those words. Many times the power of speech and deed can be lost at this time, and words and deeds have faded in so many types of social media, which have relegated them to merely impress or to be impressed by meaningless presentation. Gone are the inspirational words and deeds that are for delivering messages across that will inspire meaningful action. So, brothers and sisters, with that short exhortation, let me now proceed with our Okay, so it's a blessed morning, brothers and sisters, whenever we talk about the Word of God. And for this session, we are going to discuss the scripture readings of the fourth Sunday in ordinary time, which will be this coming Sunday. And that will come from the book of Deuteronomy, from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, from the gospel according to Saint Mark. And the first reading comes from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, verse 15 to 20. Moses spoke, let us proclaim this reading. Moses spoke to all the people, saying, "A prophet like me will the Lord your God raise up for you from among your own kin. To him you shall listen. This is exactly what you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, 'Let us not again hear the voice of the Lord our God, nor see his great fire anymore, lest we die.' And the Lord said to me, 'This was well said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their kin, and will put my words into his mouth. He shall tell them that I command him. Whoever will not listen to my words, which he speaks in my name, I myself will make him answer for it. But if a prophet presumes to speak in my name an oracle that I have not commanded him to speak, or speaks in the name of other gods, he shall die.'" And so, brothers and sisters, let us go to the context of that of our first reading. Now, the prophet of Yahweh is known to be God's representative to the people, whose mission it is his role to reveal God's will to the people. He delivers the message of God to the people. Any other form of seeking to reveal the will of God was to seek to be a rival of God's holy prophet. Sabi nga, there can be false prophets too. And this reading from the book of Deuteronomy, so a great prophet rising. Yahweh also tells the Israelites where they are to find spiritual direction, and that is the prophet that Yahweh will raise up for them. Now let us go to an exegetical analysis of the reading. We highlighted, Yahweh your God will raise up a prophet like me. You will listen to him. This is exactly what you asked Yahweh your God to do at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, "Never let me hear the voice of Yahweh my God, or see this great fire again, or I shall die." Now, Abraham is said to be the first man to be called a prophet of Yahweh in the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. Now, Abraham had the privilege actually of standing before God, and therefore was a very powerful intercessor and revealer of God's will. This was the same case with Moses. Moses is also stood before God and talked to God himself. Now, a prophet was said to be legitimately chosen by God, meaning real prophet, hindi fake prophet, if yung panahon na yon, if he was an Israelite. Two, if he spoke the words of God that God put in his mouth, and he taught the people with authority. The people had to listen to God's prophet and had to obey what they said, or else they would face divine judgment. However, if the prophet proved to be false, then he had to be put to death. The future prophet that Yahweh will raise up is said to be the promised Messiah, who, like Moses, will redeem God's people. Now, let us go to our other highlighted portion. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their kin, and will put my words into his mouth. He shall tell them all that I command him. Whoever will not listen to my words, which he speaks in my name, I myself will make him answer for it. God's command in Deuteronomy is that the people must listen to the prophet like Moses, that he sends to speak his word. Now, if we recall, brothers and sisters, if we recall the transfiguration in the New Testament, when Jesus revealed himself in his glory with Moses and Elijah, the apostles heard a voice from heaven saying, "This is my son, the beloved. He enjoys my favor. Listen to him." No? Listen to him. So, God tells us to listen to his also all the prophets that he has sent. Now, let us now go to the gospel reading for the gospel reading, which comes from the gospel according to St. Mark chapter 1, verses 21 to 28. When they came to Capernaum, and on the Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and taught. The people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. In their synagogue was a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Jesus rebuked him and said, "Quiet, come out of him." The unclean spirit convulsed him and with a loud cry came out of him. All were amazed and asked one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits and they obey him." His fame spread everywhere throughout the whole region of Galilee. As Jesus' ministry, let us now go to the context. As Jesus' ministry continues, he will begin to come to the attention of the scribes and the Pharisees. Ito yung magiging mga kalaban niya. From the beginning of Jesus' ministry, these two groups challenge Jesus' teaching authority. The scribes are usually the Levites, the lesser ministers who help the chief priests in the temple. And they are trained also as teachers of the law. After his baptism by John the Baptist and his temptation or testing in the desert, Jesus traveled north to the region of Galilee and the fishing village of Capernaum. Since the village was far from Jerusalem, the village is around 86 miles or 136 kilometers from Jerusalem, no? The people there, therefore, could not go to the temple in Jerusalem. So they worship in the synagogue at Capernaum. They also observed the Sabbath at the village synagogue, where they prayed as a community and where they also studied scripture. Now, let us now go to a short exegetical analysis of our reading. And we highlighted, then they came to Capernaum on the Sabbath. And on the Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and taught. The people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Now, every Jewish male had the right to read and comment on scriptures in the synagogue. However, the comments of Jesus had a different effect on the people. Having been just a son of a carpenter, his comments were expected to be simple and practical to a life of a craftsman. But to their surprise, this was not so when Jesus spoke of the law, which was the realm really of the scribes and the experts of the Jewish law. The scribes studied in schools of rabbis and noted experts, and this is where their authority comes from. Unlike the scribes, Jesus spoke on his own behalf, whereas people were then defined by their family's status and spoke and acted within their family structure. Jesus had ascended to a level far higher than his family status in their society. Kasi his family status then was as a craftsman, a carpenter. And yet, Jesus spoke as a prophet. one who was called directly by God. Jesus' words had power because they had an effect on the people. Jesus is the Son of God, and therefore his authority comes from God. No one can explain the law better than the author of the law, who is God. Now, let us go to our highlighted portion. In their synagogue was a man with an unclean spirit. He cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Jesus rebuked him and said, "Quiet, come out of him." The unclean spirit convulsed him, and with a loud cry came out of him. All were amazed and asked one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And so, Jesus healed a man possessed by an unclean spirit. Now, demons are spiritual beings that are the fallen angels who rebelled against God and followed Satan. The demon spirit knows and fears Jesus, recognizing not only his true identity, but even his divine power as well. So, however, unlike in an exorcism which involves a lot of names, a lot of prayers, a lot of incantation, Jesus simply gave a command and the demon left. Without the demon, the man was religiously clean again and could return to his place in society. The message about Jesus is clear. Jesus' words had the power. His command over demons only served to legitimize the power and authority of his teaching. The power of Jesus' words came from God because Jesus spoke God's word. Jesus was the conduit and mediator of divine power and providence between God and man. His teaching authority prepares the people to receive his healing authority, while his healing authority confirms and reinforces his teaching ministry. And brothers and sisters, let us now go to our second reading, which comes from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 7, verses 32 to 35. And let us proclaim this reading. "Brothers and sisters, I should like you to be free of anxieties. An unmarried man is anxious about the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But a married man is anxious about the things of the world, how he may please his wife, and he is divided. An unmarried woman or a virgin is anxious about the things of the Lord, so that she may be holy in both body and spirit. A married woman, on the other hand, is anxious about the things of the world, how she may please her husband. I am telling you this for your own benefit, not to impose a restraint upon you, but for the sake of propriety and adherence to the Lord without distraction." Now, brothers and sisters, let us look at the context of this particular letter of Paul. This is a little bit confusing, no? So that understanding the context of this portion of the letter of Paul is very critical to our understanding this reading, the message of this reading. Now, Paul seeks to reorient the Corinthian Christians away from the ascetic focus, meaning what the Corinthian Christians did was to do self-denial. But what Paul wanted them to do is to prepare for the second coming of Christ. In the process, he answers a series of questions about marriage and divorce. St. Paul tells the Corinthian Christians in chapter 7, verse 25, that he has no direction from the Lord here. I'd like you to pay attention to this, no? Where he himself says that what he wrote here in this particular portion of the letter has no direction from the Lord in these matters. But he is giving his own opinion. He believed that it is best for Christians to remain as they were, the married to stay married, and the celibate to remain celibate. He believes that Christians should divest themselves of all earthly concerns in order to prepare for Christ's second coming. And let us now go to a brief exegetical analysis. And we highlighted, I should like you to be free of anxieties. An unmarried man is anxious about the things of the Lord, how he may please the Lord. But a married man is anxious about the things of the world, how he may please his wife, and he is divided. Paul stressed the practicality of the single life. He was himself single. He was probably reflecting on his own situation. He was free to travel and preach the good news without any relationship attachment. No, he was spiritually ready for the return of the Lord, for Christ's second coming. For Paul, this was the ideal. We must realize that Paul wrote from his life experiences and his personal expectations, as Paul had earlier recognized. While his advice was and still is valid, there was another point of view which he did not address. And though single people can indeed focus clearly on the Lord, the married life also introduces certain and interference with that focus. These distractions can really contribute to the strengthening of one's spiritual life in its own way and is also favored by God. As such, the impact of single or married life depends on our call from the Lord, which is our vocation. So, what is our vocation? Is our vocation the single life or is our vocation the married life? Now, let us go to another highlighted portion. I am telling you this for your own benefit, not to impose restraint upon you, but for the sake of propriety and adherence to the Lord without distraction. Paul expresses the opinion that if one is called to devote his or her life to the Lord, it is a commitment that is better achieved in a state of celibacy. Parang yung sa pare, ano? So as not to have a heart that is divided between the Lord and family obligations. Paul was not making a rule, though, for anyone to follow. This was not a rule. He advised that because of the circumstances in Corinth, he encouraged the unmarried to take advantage of their situation. And so that ends our brief exegetic analysis of our reading. Let us now go to our collatio or sharing portion. And we have discussion questions. So our first discussion question, of course, you may share also your own Lectio Divina experiences, but you may also answer these questions as part of your sharing. When was the last time you had witnessed an authoritative talk that moved you to meaningful action? No, sometimes we hear somebody say something and this makes an impact on ourselves that it moves us to action, like changing our lives. Have you ever talked to others in an authoritative manner? And did it move them to life-giving action? We have, as our guest today, in our talk tank panelists, Brother Ed Cueto, Sister Sonia, Sister Juliet was supposed to be but pero wala yata, and Sister Gina Barreras. Okay, so it's a blessed afternoon, brothers and sisters. Is there anything that you would like to share with us about our readings or yung questions, ano? Curious yung questions eh. Kasi sabi natin, have you ever heard an authoritative talk that have moved you to action? Yung something na narinig nyo na naging life-changing for you? Or, on the reverse, have you ever given an authoritative talk that changed the life of others? Anybody would like to say something about our reading?
Sarang, I heard so many authoritative talks, ano, mga pare, ano. Maingay yung aso. I heard marami na akong authoritative talks, especially yung mga priest, ano, sa retreat, sa teaching, sa mga ganyan, ano. Pero yung those talk that move me to a meaningful action, so far wala pa akong maisip, ano. Wala akong maisip eh.
Ibig sabihin, hindi ka na.
hindi ko matanda kung alin dun eh. O tsaka kung ano yun. Yung ano. Bagay, matagal na. Yung ano yung talk ng aming spiritual director sa charismatic na nagbigay ng talk about discipleship. Very authoritative. Kasi ano yun, ex-seminary yan eh. So marami siyang alam talaga no about discipleship. Then with that talk niya, apat na session yun, no, I was moved to make a quest to be a disciple of God by reading the Bible. That was mga 28, 17, 16 niya tayo, no? Mga 2016 pa. Pero nahirapan akong magbasa ng Bible, hindi ko maintindihan. Mga 2016. So pare no, naisip ko lang ano. Yan, binanggit yung number 2 naman, have you ever talked to others in authoritative manner? Did it move them to a life-giving action? Actually, I did not talk them one by one, personally, one on one. But doon sa nagbigay ako ng talk about what is the real meaning of the prayer given by Lord Jesus to the disciple, the Lord's Prayer. And of course, it moved them to life-giving action. That means they really began to understand it's not just a simple prayer, no? But it has so many meaning. Especially yung sarili kong talk, ano, na-move ako dun sa the bread, ano, give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. Before that talk na ginawa ko, what I understood is that yung bread sa lamesa, ano, bread on the table, ano, money, provision, ano. But exactly, hindi pala yun.
Hindi pala yun.
Marang ibig sabihin. Yung bread na yun, ano? Number one, Jesus is the bread of life. So you must take the communion because Jesus is the bread of life, diba? And you must read the Bible because the Bible is the word of God and the word of God is life. Yun. Parang yun ang nag-move sa akin dun sa sarili kong talk, ano? And hopefully, yung mga nakinig sa akin ay may mga, meron din silang mga life-giving action to themselves. Yun lang so far, masasabi ko. Thank you.
Brother Ed. Sometimes, meron tayong mga, kahit hindi talk eh, yun lang usapan natin na ordinaryong usapan na kumisan nahihit tayo. Ma'am, meron lang tayong kausap ng somebody. Hindi siya nagbibigay ng talk, hindi siya nagbibigay ng formal teaching. Pero yung usapan natin, yun yung nakatama sa atin, yun ang nakahit sa atin. So, sometimes yun ang ganun tayo nagkakaroon ng realization, no? Na dapat pala ganun. No? Meron ko minsan nakikinig ako sa yung nag-uusapan lang kami. Miski dito sa atin, itong ating ginagawa dito, itong sharing. sometimes meron ako naririnig dito na tama nga pala, ganun nga pala. Yung sinasabi ng isa sa atin, no? And it becomes a life-changing ano a matter sa atin. Yung mga sinasabi niyo, yung mga yan. Kung minsan meron kayong mga sinasabi na ano yung realization ko. Now, hopefully, ang maganda nun, hopefully, when we ourselves talk to others, sana naman eh, meron din silang mapulot sa atin. Yeah. Anything else? Anybody would like to add to that? Ikaw ba?
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. I just remember Dick and I. Dick and I had our usual we were having discussion with our spiritual director. I argue with my the my, with our spiritual director regarding being competitive. And he told me that we should not be competitive and instead we should be humble. I cannot understand what he is trying to tell me, because during that time I was still stubborn. So we ended up not parang ano, parang hindi kami nagkaano, hindi maganda yung paghiwalay namin. Ang sabi pa sa kanya, "Father, you hurt me." Tapos ano, after that I prayed and I was really bothered. Sabi ko, meron ata ako, I did something wrong. So I prayed to God, "Lord, help me. Maybe I should change my own ways. I should not be competitive." Pero it took a while before I ano na naintindihan ko what the my I'm spiritual director is trying to tell me. Until hindi na kami nagkita after that eh. He was very busy, and then I just heard that he died during the pandemic. And I said, "Baby, after a while, unti-unti, nawawala na yung pagiging competitive ko." Tapos parang, sabi ko, ganun lang pala yun, ano, hindi pala importante. Parang I have realized it. Siguro he kept on praying for me. Kaya I sometimes pray to him. Sabi ko, "Thank you. You have changed me." So yun ang isa sa mga I remember. And then, dun sa ano naman, number two, have you ever talked to others in an authoritative manner and it moved them to life-giving action? Nag-ano ako, binasa ko yung text ng family namin, group chat. Tapos my sister, my two sisters, they were arguing. Talagang mag-aaway na talaga. So, ang ginawa ko, what I did, ayoko na sumali kasi lalo nang lalaki yung gulo. So, what I did, I posted the picture of my dad and mom. Then, sinasabi ko na I admire my mommy and my parents, that they did everything to mold us and made us, the reason why we are like this, because of them. So inano ko yon, in-emphasize ko yun, and then I said that maybe it's we should continue to love one another and extend it to the next generation. I thought that they will be irritated, but on the contrary, most of my sisters and even my brother, they were glad that I posted that message to them, And they were really, parang they were, parang you, I made them very happy. So, doon, so sabi ko, ah, kaya ko naman pala. Kahit ganito lang ako. Kaya kong ma-change yung ano nila, yung what they think about these things. Yung huwag ng negative, ano nila, positive. Now, I will go to my reflection. In today's world, unclean spirits can be understood as the negative influence or dark forces that misguide us away from a life of virtue and purpose. They are the voices that sow doubt, fear, and despair. They are the temptations that lead us astray and the habits that entangle us in the web of negativity and sin. Who are they? These are demons existing in this world. All of us are afraid of these demons, and it is frightening to know that they are constantly preying on us, wanting to destroy us. Back in time, in heaven, there was an angel called Lucifer, who acted contrary to the wishes of God. Consequently, God cast him away from heaven to earth. As a result of this, there were other angels who fell on the same direction and followed Lucifer. They are fallen angels. God did not strip away their natural powers. Using these natural powers, these demons are capable of communicating with human beings and exercising influence over our lives here on earth. Because they fell from the grace of God, they cannot have everything good in them, only the bad and the evil. So they only have an evil influence over us. To influence us, the demons will use material and worldly things to lead us into sin. In the case in the scripture, the poor man had given into the wishes of the devil. That is why the demons have taken full control over him. That poor man was liberated by Jesus. He confronted and overpowered the demons with much ease. Jesus Christ has the power over all demons and evil. Meditation. In this holy text, we find strength and guidance to discern right from wrong and the courage to resist the lures of negativity. To avoid these unclean spirits, we must anchor ourselves in faith and truth. Just as Jesus taught in the synagogue with authority, we too should immerse ourselves in the wisdom and the teachings of the Holy Scripture. Moreover, prayer and meditation are five vital tools in this battle. They connect us with the divine, fortify our spirits, and provide us with peace necessary to navigate life's challenges. By regularly engaging in these spiritual practices, we create a sanctuary within ourselves. We avoid the corrupting influence of the world. Community is also crucial. Surrounding ourselves with people who uplift, support, and encourage us in our faith journey can significantly diminish the power of the negative influence. Lastly, we must actively practice love, kindness, and forgiveness. They possess the power to transform not only our lives, but also the lives of those around us. Contemplation. O Lord, I praise and thank you for making me realize that I have hurt you many times because of my stubbornness. Every time I prepare for our community, Lectio Divina, I am always enlightened. You are so loving and merciful. Act. We humbly ask our Lord Jesus Christ to grant me the courage to be the light and hope to others. May I also sow love, kindness, and forgiveness to others. Thank you, brothers and sisters.
Thank you, Sister Gina. No, siguro do sa senior mo, especially yung influence sa yun ng mga ibang tao, how it changed your life, no? We are talking about those in authority telling us, kagaya ng spiritual director, telling us how to live our lives better. No? Pero doon sa isang sharing mo na ikaw naman yung naka-influence sa iba, I guess the realization there is, no matter how simple the words that we will use to talk to others, sabi mo nga, sinabi mo lang naman na dapat magmahalan yung magkakapatid, it still has an authority in it. So, ibig sabihin, all of us can talk authoritatively. Hindi lang yung people who have the training, but people also, in terms of ordinary speech, can talk authoritatively, especially when what we say influences the life of others. Thank you, Sister Gina. Any other? Sister Sonia, meron ka ba masasabi?
Brother Deet, actually, for a while, actually, dun sa first question, but if I have heard an authoritative talk or somebody who influenced me spiritually, several na, in a retreat in Tagaytay, and the speaker was Father Lambert, the topic was the love of God, and that the verses taken were in 1 John, taken in 1 John. And so, kasi love is so, I would say, vague at times. Hindi mo siya nahahawakan eh. You feel it. You don't see it. Though you should understand it when it is expressed in word, in deed. So, nung time na yon, I was just listening. I have heard this gospel, these verses before, but the meaning of the verses was not that deep inside. And so when it was discussed, when he discussed this verse, we are of God, whoever knows God listens to us. Whoever is not of God does not listen to us. This way we know the spirit of truth from the spirit of error. Most beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. Open time sa family, parang taken for granted yung mga expression of love. And I grew up in a family na ganong tipo. So as I was, how would I say that? Bringing up my kids as they grow, nahihirapan akong iparamdam yung love. Because I grew up in a family ni na hindi ka-deep ang expression ng love. Or most likely, they do not understand the verses of the Bible because it is something na hindi ginagawa. And oftentimes, pati yung pagsisimba is not something na religious being done. So after that retreat, ang daming nabago sa akin. I have learned to yield to my husband more sincerely. Yung really thinking of God, not thinking of him as my husband. And then I have tried to ano, to parang let my guards out as far as my kids are. If they answer me back in a way na hindi ako masaya, I will just keep quiet. Parang I have learned to express the love toward them by being humble, by being attentive, by being more understanding, not putting my authority on top of them, but rather yielding to them, listening to them, and trying to understand them after praying. And so those talks were really so influential on me. It helped me a lot to be a better person. But of course, God is not contented with just us being better. God is for us to be the best of what He has created, because we were all created in the image of God. And so we should always be. We should always be really trying to be in the image of God, as far as ourselves and God, and most of all, in our relation with others. Parang dumawak yung pang-unawa ko. Pwede na akong sagutin ng kahit sino, unlike before when I would always impose by being a parent, by being a provider to my siblings, and by being, I would even say, educated, something like that. Kasi the family is not really that, ano, not all were college graduate and so forth. So, ang laki-laki ng, ano nun, ang effect nun sa akin, parang na-widen yung horizon ko ng understanding, ng love, and humility. Now, as far as yung me talking as an authority, this happens often because catechist ako eh. And my audience are children, so they really look at a catechist with respect. So being childish talaga, the kids oftentimes go beyond. They test your patience, unknowingly they do. Pero alam mo, oftentimes when I discuss the Bible verse, the Sunday Bible verse, may reaction eh. You would know how they receive the verse or the reading by the reaction. Merong biglang umiyak, and that happened twice already, and then merong suddenly nag-sorry. Nag-sorry mismo sa akin. So, those things are manifestations of not really an authority, but your effect on them as they listen to you. In fact, I would cite an example when a 12-year-old boy suddenly cried after I discussed something. I was puzzled. Sabi ko, did I offend? Or did I touch something really deep in the heart of the boy? And so, inakbayan kong ganon, and then I said, oh, do you have a problem? Or is there something bothering? And so the boy said, kasi po, teacher, before I came here, sinagot-sagot po ang mama ko. And the topic was respect of parents, love for family, and unity of the family. And then sabi ko, ngayong marinig mo yung ating ano gospel, tingin mo anong gustong pagawa sa iyo ni God? And the boy was so instant in his answer. Kailangan po akong mag-sorry sa mama ko. Pero hindi ko po alam kung paano gawin. And that was the problem of the boy. But it was so touching because the word of God really pierced the heart of the boy to the point na na-realize niya na nagkamali siya, na nakasakit siya, and there was that desire to make up. And so, as I was listening, I asked God, Lord, how do you want this done? How do you want the boy to do it? And so, I told the boy, you don't have to really explain and so forth. The admission that, Mama, I'm sorry, nasaktan kita, but you know I love you. That was the simple thing. Tapos paribasa lalaki, hesitant, kasi ganun ang boy eh. They tried not to release or to open their heart. Sabi ko, may isang paraan. You can write. Sabi ko, ganun. Pinakasimple salita mo ilagay, ibigay mo sa mama mo. Sabay may dala kang coffee. And so after that, Actually, I failed to ano na to ask what had happened, but I guess it was done by the boy, because the following sessions the boy was have been so attentive from that time on. And then itong recent na I was transferred to another level because 12 years old na sila, grade 6. So interaction with the family is really so important. Grade 4 na ako ngayon, nakita ko siya ulit. Sabi ko, oh, kamusta ka na? Sabi ko ganun, mabuti po. Sabi ko, I'm happy, nagtutuloy ka kasi bagong taon tayo, nandito ka pa. Opo, ma'am, hindi po ako aalis. So now, I realize really the catechists are important persons in the life of others because it is God who works on them, not us really working because we deserve to be authoritative. It is the word of God that works. Whatever reception, as far as the audience is concerned, si Lord ang gagawa noon. Si Lord ang magbibigay ng meaning to all the works and to all the verses na binasa. Now about the Bible, actually, I didn't prepare something na talagang ano, specific. But there are some things that I would like to ano, to discuss. Jesus was really an authority. Hindi ito something na bi that na question. Pero ang naramdaman ko when I was reading the ano, the gospel, sabi ko, Lord, hindi pala kami dapat matakot sa temptation. What we need is to yield to your will. Because if your will is in us, who can overcome? So that was the first realization I had. And then the second one is Jesus speaks no useless words. And so we have to be attentive. Ito kasi ang pinakamahirap sa tao eh. Attentive. Oftentimes, kahit hindi mo gusto, may naglalaro sa isip mo, mga worldly concerns. Then another thing, because we all want to be in heaven, I have realized heaven is not a place. It is a state of being with God. And whenever we are attentive to God, we are in an encounter with Him. So the reason why we pray or the reason why we read the Bible is to have an encounter with God. And that encounter we should not miss. Then another one, whatever I do as I read the Bible, as I listen to talks, or as I listen to the sharing of kids as far as their problem is concerned, I plunge myself into the light of God. Because God ang magbibigay ng light eh, for you to help them. It is not your wisdom that will count, but it is the light from God na pag narinig mo yung concern ng kapwa mo, it will be God who will give you the message kung ano ang sasabihin mo if you submit to Him. Then another thing, if we are attentive, but does that follow God? It can happen that she might remain, that person or we might remain to be half of the way. Maiista ka sa gitna. Hindi ka makakarating sa dulo. Because nakinig ka pero hindi mo sinunod yung binigay na message ni God. And for a while, ah. And it will be a sorrow for me kung umabot ako sa ganun. Because from you try to strive, pero pagdating sa gitna, bumigay ka. Either because you felt hopeless or nabother ka na ibang bagay na worldly. Sayang. Kasi andun ka na sa gitna, maiiwan ka pa or mahuhuli ka pa. And then, isa pang napakahalaga, I realize hinil ni God yung tao because that person is a creation of God. And every creation of God, all the people created by God, ang gusto ni God, God the Father, ay mapunta sa bosom niya. hindi maiwan. And so, at the end of our life, our desire is to be with God the Father, our Creator. Alam mo, one thing na lagi ko iniisip, Lord, nung una, nung hindi pa ako active sa, ano talaga, sa reading of the Bible, eh God yun, ako'y tao, how can I be created by God in His image? Now I realize, I cannot be on my own, be in the image of God. But God, when I submit myself to God and let God accomplish everything in me, it is God who is doing everything. And so I am in the image of God. Ngayon, napakadaming realization when you study the Bible. I really appreciate everything that even listening lang, I would take notes eh. Oftentimes, hindi ko naman mababasa lahat, but in the Cenacle or in even in Masses, I take notes. Our spiritual maturity will not be complete if we do not allow God to accomplish His designs and plans for us. We have to be attentive and faithful to God. Yung plans, noon, ang dali kong maggawa ng plano para bang detalyado pa. Pag ganitong edad, pag ganitong ano. Para bang lahat dinidictate po kay God. God, pagdating ko ng ganitong edad, I should be there. God, pagdating ng ganitong edad ang anak ko, they should be have accomplished this thing. Something like that. Ngayon, hindi na. Na-realize ko na, no matter what I do, no matter what my kids do, pag hindi ito plano ng God, hindi ito matutupad. And I always believe God's plan is the best. Now, as far as yung aking prayer, isa lang lagi eh ang nasa isip ko. Lord, if you accomplish everything in me, it will be perfect. But if I left myself over anong tawag doon, disobey you, I will always be at the losing end. And so, napaka-importante sa akin that I have this communication with you. Every moment as much as possible, pero mahirap gawin. Pero in those moments na I will try my best to be really attentive to him. May alam ko si God yung nagsusuport. Si hindi ko yun kaya on my own. And then lastly, I would always want to be the instrument of God for the betterment of another person, because I cannot be better if my fellow men are not getting better. I have to be the example of them. I have to lead them to the right way, not to the for them to be lost. Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Sonia. So indeed, you know, that was very enlightening. Yung sabi mo nga, yield to the will of God, no, and be attentive to God, and na nakatulong sa iyo yung Bible. Well, why else could hindi makatulong, dahil it is indeed God's word, you know, kaya ito ay authoritative para sa atin. So well, ang nung pinapakinggan ko yung lahat na sharings niyo, na-realize ko lang, no, na sometimes yung authority, we try to think that it is something that has to do with training, with being knowledgeable, with being able to say something that is intelligent. Pero hindi, no, we too, no, tayong mga ordinaryong mga tao can have authoritative influence on others in terms of our simple words. No, yung sabi mo nga yung bata eh biglang may nag-realization na nangyari sa kanya, no? So being authoritative does not only belong to the learned or the experts, but it also belongs to all of us as long as we are there to see to it. Sabi mo nga that to be an instrument to others. Yeah. Anything that the others would like to add pa to do sa discussion natin? Meron pa ba kayo dadagdag? Kung wala na, let us ano. I will share with you my thoughts. So let me share with you just some of my thoughts. So why must I learn to listen to the gentle authority of God's word? And how can I move others to life-giving action? I also call to mind a verse from Psalm, "If today you hear his voice, harden not your hearts." And so we have learned so many, we have heard so many talks about so many subjects that seek to move us into action. Some of these are forceful, arrogant, and threatening to the extent that they virtually bully us into action, while some are soft, weak, and do not make an impression on us that they are easily disregarded and forgotten. So how can we learn to say something with authority that is gentle and inviting to life-giving action? Now, the book of Deuteronomy tells us that the Lord promised to send a prophet who will reveal God's will to us. However, we are warned to listen to this prophet because when he comes, he will move us into action and towards our redemption and salvation. He will bring us to God's word, and this promised prophet is no other than the word of God, Jesus Christ. Sabi nga natin, who could be more authoritative than the word of God? Saint Mark describes the teachings of Jesus as having authority, which is different from the teachings of the scribes, whose authority only comes from what they have studied in the law. The authority of Jesus comes from within him, who is the Word of God himself. His healing action confirms and reinforces the power of his words. His power and authority shows that he is indeed the mediator of divine providence between God and man. Saint Paul tells us of his own opinion, which did not come from the direction of the Lord. Though this portion of Paul's letter is directly from Paul's life experiences and personal expectations, he speaks of this in accord with his own personal authority. He speaks with authority especially about the advantages of his personal vocation of single blessedness in life. Truly, our experience can also become reliable. Our life experiences can become reliable sources of our own personal authoritative witnessing, as all of you have said also in your sharings. In this day and age of social media, we hear and see a lot of talk and actions that are either real or just made up. We receive messages and videos that insist to be authorities on the subject matter that they claim to cover. This either move us to action or move us to react to their claims. Our actions and reactions are responses of either belief and agreement or doubt and rejection. So who can we really trust to be authorities on what they profess? If we are looking for the real authority on life, then the only real authentic source is the Word of God in the Bible, which they say is always reliable and relevant yesterday, today, and tomorrow. But how can we, as witnesses, relay our experiences and learnings in an authoritative manner that elicit a meaningful response in others? Just like Paul, we have to be grounded on the Word, which is Christ, and clear as to our spiritual role and vocation in life, so that our passion then becomes our personal authority. With that, brothers and sisters, our next session is on February 14. Medyo mahirap to, no? I know you may have your own mga lakad, pero yun yung regular schedule eh. And the Mass comes from the Holy Mass of February 28, which is the first Sunday of Lent. No, the first Sunday of Lent. The readings will come from Genesis, First Letter of Peter, and Gospel of St. Mark. So with that, brothers and sisters, let us close this session with a prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us all be still and know that God is always just there beside us. Father, we praise and thank you for allowing us to hear your word today. Thank you, Lord, for the guidance that you have given us, for the realizations that you have allowed us to have from your word. Father, we continue to ask you to look after us. Father, you are the source of everything in life, and allow us to listen to you as our authority in life. For this, Lord, please hear our prayer. My brothers and sisters may want to have say something also.
Almighty Father, I praise and thank you for always being there for us. Thank you, Lord, for always enlightening me to all the by using people. Lord, I also praise and thank you for protecting all of us from harm, from the danger, from the evil one, and providing for all our needs. For all of this, Lord, we praise you and we thank you.
Yes, Lord, we praise you and we thank you, Lord. Brothers and sisters, let us pray. Father, we praise and thank you for your authoritative word that guides us in our daily life. Teach us to be your witnesses to others on matters where we can be of assistance as we fulfill the roles that you have given to us as members of the body of Christ. Brothers and sisters, let us listen to this next song and make it a part and ponder it in our hearts, make it a part of our closing prayer.
Oh, into the heights we went in darkness, longing for truth, greater to you. Make us so your only food, I forgot how to see. Oh, sweet longing to see to many hungry, longing to and still thirst, make us your broken for others, share and take all my friends. No need to shame to make me harmless. Only fool for every other.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Name the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.